everybody. Today we're going to have a webinar dedicated to the evaluation of creditworthiness, which is part of our common series of the webinars which we are doing together with Creditinfo. Traditionally, I start with Thanksgiving and with my special thanks to Emma Canvieri, who is our host today and who actually made it possible personally to have this series of webinar. Thank you very much, Emma. And let me go directly to my favorite slide, where I simply introduced the companies and organizations who made this series of webinars possible. Is first of all Creditinfo and Creditinfo Academy. This is my organization, which is called ACCWE, Association of Credit for Central and Eastern Europe, where I am a development director. Our friendly organization, which is Polish Institute of Credit Management, with whom we are working together on many different things related to credit management as well. And let me also mention credit engineering, which is a small project helping to promote the credit management and the credit, trade credit decision making within the organization and help them to be smarter and more effective in the area of credit management. So the topic today would be creditworthiness. Let us start with the simple understanding what it is, creditworthiness. Before we jump into it, I will simply introduce our schedule. So we are planning to do that within near 40 minutes. During which I do encourage you to actually interrupt, to ask your questions, to type your questions in the chat, and I will be trying my best to answer them. If it would not be suitable, I will answer all of them in the end of our webinar. There would be question and answers section where you will be able to ask your questions. And again, if all of this will fail in the end, you can. There are my contact details in the presentation, and Emma can help with them, or you can simply find me on the LinkedIn, and I will be happy to answer all of your questions, let's say directly or privately. Okay, now let's get started. So, creditworthiness. If you try to Google the word creditworthiness, you will find a lot of definitions, majority of which will be advising that the creditworthiness is an ability of the company to take and repay a credit of a certain form. It could be either loan or trade credit or, I don't know, hire purchase, whatever type of credit we take. So it is actually a company's ability to borrow the money and repay their obligations. This is more or less common and this is more or less clear until we try to measure it. And the measurement of creditworthiness is already an issue because creditworthiness itself is actually linked not to something which is firm and clear. Here we are coming from precise math and precise accounting of the past. We suppose to go to the future and try to assess it. And, you know, like I think it's this is Elon Musk who says that, you know, the only thing we know about the future, we don't know it precisely, or we cannot know it precisely. This is completely true. The majority of the methodologies and the, you know, and the papers and the pieces of academic works presume that creditworthiness is to be measured as a default probability, which is truth, and which is, I mean, it is not like right or wrong. This is an advice which is coming from the most common basic banking piece of the alignment or accord, or let's call it regulations, which is called Basel, where the creditworthiness is measured by the default probability. These two things are linked, but if we go to the trade credits, okay, default probability is good, but we need to know how much money we can trust to the specific customer without taking a collateral or security of a certain form. Because, you know, if we try to discuss with the colleagues in our sales department, the default probability is, I don't know, 12% or 0.12 out of one, you know, people who are non-specialists, people who are not sitting, you know, working with this every day, they simply say, so what? 12% is not too bad. It's less than 20% out of 100. So why should we cancel the credit? Because if we go to the banking system, we will see that, you know, 12% or default probability of 0.12 is quite high. It's quite high. So therefore, for the, I mean, I'm not trying to judge about the banking system, about the loans where there are specific regulations, where there are much more specialists better than me knowing the banking credit and also, you know, pricing. Banking credit is kind of different type of credit, different from trade credit. But in trade credit, we need to know the amount. Therefore, my presentation and the further discussion would be about the word worth. So how much we can give to a specific customer or entity or business without a special security, without any security, simply as a matter of trust, being more or less sure that this amount will be repaid. Because this is exactly what we need when we try to structure a trade credit transaction with our customer. This is exactly what we need to understand how much credit we can give and how much credit we need to give to a customer in order to achieve our sales target. This concept actually is based on the quite simple understanding. We are living in the competitive world, and companies compete for the customers. Companies do compete for the purchases, and companies do compete for the volume going through the customer. Therefore, in such a competitive environment of the, say, last 30 years, it is nearly impossible to choose customers. We are looking, we try to sell, if you try to see how much efforts companies take on marketing, on sales, on building their sales departments, and so on and so on and so on. And then there is a credit department or, you know, credit team who says, you know, the sale is not complete until it is paid for. And, you know, we don't like this customer, ask them to send the prepayment. And at the same time, you know, the customer says, okay, no problem, I'm going to have extended credit from depart other customers from your five competitors. So you try to sell your products on prepayment basis, and I wish you good luck in business. So it is always right balance. Therefore, we try to compare the creditworthiness of the customer in terms of decision making. We try to compare it with the credit demand. The credit demand, or you can call it projected receivables, which is a function or derivative, if you want, from the sales. So, for instance, we've got a customer who is capable to purchase from us for, say, $1 million worth, which you know, over a year, which would mean that they would need that their credit that the credit demand or demand for credit would be about the same $1 million a month with a 30 days payment term, or $500,000 with a 15 days payment term, and so on and so on. The math is simple, but then in order to, this is the amount of credit we need to provide to our customer to make him able to purchase these goods from us without security, so that the transaction goes smoothly. And then we have to evaluate, and as you will see later on, it is not even evaluation, it is rather estimation of how creditworthy our customer is. So how much money we can trust them without being worried. And then we compare the two and we take a decision, what would be the credit term, what would be the credit limit, what would be a collateral if necessary. For instance, if creditworthiness is below the credit demand, we either take this risk of difference or we ask for security of that equivalent, a little bit of more or less the same amount of difference between the creditworthiness and the credit demand. Or we can reduce the credit demand by shortening the credit term. And so on and so on and so on. There is no right recipe over here. These slides and the methodology is actually helping us to be clear about what we do. And actually try to take smarter, you know, being much more smarter in our decision and being transparent. So with this methodology, it is possible to go to sales who are not specialists in finance and, you know, be clear with them. Because, I know, one small remark, after all of my discussions, we were discussing that, you know, on previous webinars, I think I already mentioned that, you know, there is a presumption within the finance and credit teams that, you know, salespeople are like more concentrated on volumes and they don't care about anything else. In the end, you know, sales work, if somebody of you try to do that, is quite hard. And the last thing they are interested about is to have bankruptcy or failure of their customer. And based on that simple fact, you would be surprised, but smart salespeople, the most professional salespeople, are actually the best audience for their credit risk and credit worthiness assessment, because if something happens to their customer, they are not losing only receivables, they are losing all the future sales with this customer. And this is bad for everybody, because again, if we try to take this motto of credit departments where we say the sale is not completed until it is paid for, but to be paid for, we need to sell first. And the credit, and actually the effectiveness of credit management and credit itself, is significantly concerned with credit function's ability to generate more sales, to facilitate more sales. Therefore, we've got actually two directions in our job: making sure we are paid, and making sure and make sure we do sell. So, credit decision making is quite a long process, and it is not a subject of our today's webinar. Today we are talking about our today's subject is creditworthiness itself. How can we assess, or as I said, that it would be much more better term to say, how can we estimate it and understand how much money we can give to a customer relatively safe without taking any additional security. Key principles, or where can we start? We need to define the specific amount of money we can invest. But again, we start from the very, very, very basic things. These key principles, I'm pretty sure you as a specialist can find much more of them. I just found the most major mistakes companies do and my colleagues do in their practice. First one is we need to define precisely the counterpart we are dealing with. Here is, you know, many of you might hear that, okay, this is the entity which belongs to a big multinational group or which has an ownership of the reputable businessman. And, you know, all the statements like this, I've seen them in many credit requests. All of these statements are correct as long as we take them as a company's reputation, as long as we take them as a general background of dealing with a specific customer, as well as you know, prospective of dealing with the customer. You know, something like we are signing a contract with the company out of this group, so there is a prospective for us to grow business. But in terms of simply creditworthiness, we're supposed to judge only on entity we are dealing with and its own standalone financial position. We like it or not, but we are dealing with the customer. Obviously, that there would be a possibility that in terms of financial difficulties of this entity, the group can help. But at the same time, this group can actually take substantial amount of cash out of this company just by management decision. That, you know, both possibilities are equal. You know, the basic principle of credit which we need to remember, and this is in terms of law, this is the concept of limited liability. So the impact of ownership on the entity is pretty simple. The owner is only liable for the obligations of the entity, of the business, or the company, only to the extent of money invested into this company. Meaning that owner is not responsible for the debt until we've got a special arrangement like parental guarantee or owner guarantee or something like that. But in this case, we take an obligation from this owner already, not from the entity. So this means that we transfer our credit risk on the owner. This is very important to remember. I won't be elaborating too much on that. It is pretty clear. Again, try to understand also just one necessary thing is that, like, if we've got an entity, for instance, let's take, I don't know, Apple. Apple is a group of companies which would be, like, I don't know, several hundreds of entities around the globe. And they would be located. They would be located in different countries. And when we assess the creditworthiness or financial stance of a specific entity, it will be also affected if we, for instance, sell to them from the other country. It would be also affected by the country risk of the country this specific entity is located in. I'm just trying to say that, you know, Apple or Coca-Cola, I don't know, Intel, United States and Intel, Timbuktu, would be absolutely two different, legally would be two different entities located in two different countries with a different credit worthiness. And we need to be very, very precise on that. What do I mean under zero compliance tolerance? This means that assessment of credit worthiness and credit worthiness itself exists only where there is 100% compliance with all of the legal provisions affecting such a transaction. Any deviation from the law create additional credit risk, create a possibility you won't be paid. And if there is something incompliant, I'm talking about sanctions, I'm talking about something which could be, you know, viewed as legal by the customer or by the legal system of the country, or you consciously have to do something which could be, I don't know, could be trusted, you know, semi-legal or illegal. This means that the credit worthiness of the, you know, the assessment of credit worthiness really, you know, either very much discounted or does not make any sense. So the transaction you do with your customer or supplier, which presumes providing of credit, supposed to be 100% legal, otherwise you go to the gray zone where everything could happen, so you cannot rely on customer credit worthiness anymore. This means that, for instance, your customer or supplier supposed, I mean, can find a way not to pay or not to deliver goods and so on. And the third principle is the right stage. I already mentioned that in many, in the webinars we were discussing that, and in some other discussions with the colleagues and specialists and non-specialists, and that. Say that, as I said in the very beginning, we cannot choose customers, and the credit worthiness of a customer could not be the only single measurement which defines we deal or we don't deal with this or that specific customer. Therefore, evaluation of credit worthiness or credit risk assessment is an important, you know, very important part of the decision-making process, but it is not the ready-made decision yet. There could be different situations, there could be different business opportunities, and so on and so on, where we simply deal with the customer of low or zero credit worthiness, with the customers with, I don't know, with low credit ratings and with no guarantee. I had, in my experience, a project where we are dealing with an entity in Nigeria, which is not the, you know, highest, you know, country credit rating in the world, as you may understand, without saying anything about the country and people within there. We're talking about only, you know, credit rating. And I won't be telling you about the company's balance sheet and, you know, P&L and all the financial ratios. Financial ratios, it was, I would say, very far from being good. We entered into that transaction because it was a kind of special project, but it was significant, I would say, substantial amount of credit. You know, entrusted to a customer, but in the end, this customer was paying on time, and as far as I know, I'm talking to my colleagues. And they do pay. I was talking to my colleague that the project is successful. We've got a question. You say that credit worthiness assessment is the only allowed measure when issuing loans. What are known the most popular loopholes? How do financial institutions try going around this rule? Dima, I'm sorry. I think we will come back to that question right in the end, because I will ask you to repeat that question and a little bit rephrase, because I'm not sure I can pick up quickly what is the question. One correction I would like to say in this is that creditworthiness assessment is applicable to every credit transaction, and credit transaction is relatively everything. We were discussing in previous webinars, if we go to the, I don't know, to the retail outlet and buy a bottle of Coca-Cola, there is credit in this transaction as well. Because we first give money and then take a bottle, or vice versa. But anyway, that would be that would be credit. Our next stage is where we can get the information. So in the end of the creditworthiness assessment, we need to give a simple amount of money which we can trust to a customer. We're supposed to say, once again, if you remember in the announcement of the webinar, I was saying how we can, as a credit specialist, how we can communicate that creditworthiness to the outside world. In the outside world, in the world outside the finance, outside the accounting, outside the credit analysis, outside the finance, people would be very hard to understand even default probability. Our default probability across the portfolio or value at risk would be, you know, as far from their understanding as you can imagine. Therefore, we need to come to communicate, because, you know, credit assessment or credit management function is not actually standalone within the business. When we do a trade credit, the credit is not the product itself, in contrast to the banks where the credit is product, the loan is a product. In trade credit, the credit is a way, or I don't know, as a facilitation or a service which is coming together with products and it helps to make a transaction happen and to move the product on through the, you know, trade value chain. Therefore, we need to be clear with the people who don't understand credit how we can reflect the credit risk. And when we compare credit worthiness in money as a certain amount with the credit demand, here it is everything become clear. So we need to give a customer a million and their credit worthiness is, I'm sorry, 1,000. Okay, do we ready to put $1 million under risk? You know, and what do we get in the end? What would be the profit of the transaction? Then the discussion starts. But we already understand clearly what is the credit risk and what is the credit demand and how can we do about, what can we do about the difference. On the slide, I will try to touch it very shortly. There are many more sources of information, credit information about the customer, but I try to reflect here only those which are able, or let's say capable, to provide more or less comprehensive information about the counterparty to assess them and define their credit worthiness. So it could be similar to the bank, it could be counterpart or a trade partner itself. If we look at the work of the, you know, credit department of a bank, customers easily go there with their financial statements, with the, you know, substantial amount of information about themselves, prepare this everything, then bank look at the qualitative factors, quantitative factors, and decide whether or not the loan of certain amount with this customer is possible. Depending on the product, depending on the I would say supplier or credit grantor, bargaining capacity, or, you know, negotiation power. The customer or trade partner would be more or less willing to provide information about themselves. It's quite normal. For instance, I've seen quite recent examples in the, you know, jurisdictions where normally you don't expect somebody to show their financial statements, but when it comes down to, say, oil business, just, you know, one click, can you give us your financial statements? In 2 hours, you got it. Where, you know, customers are more important, you know, got more importance in that, you know, in that supply chain, they simply say, no, we don't show our financial statements to anybody unless you ask, unless it is bank or somebody, la, 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 la. So sometimes that. And in the Middle East, there is no common tradition to share or disclose financial statements with the suppliers. But in some exceptional cases, this happens, especially when, you know, there is really a decision making. My practice shows, I got an example when we simply came to customer, okay, there was a decision about increase of the credit line, and we have to either ask for bank guarantee, which is supposed to be paid by somebody, or ask customer to provide financial statement. Yeah, we had to sign non-disclosure agreement. We gave our, you know, reasonable promises not to disclose this information to anybody. We received financial statements, we analyzed them, and gave customer unsecured credit because we finally understood their financial position. This is possible. Again, it's a question how you achieve that in practice. Information from state registers. Sometimes in some jurisdictions you can have financial statements. Sometimes you can have only compliance information. Again, the problem is there could be several different registers related to different aspects of business. Some of them dealing with registration, some of them with the bankruptcy proceedings, some of them with the tax proceedings, and so on and so on. So it might take some time to collect all of this information, which could be, you know, relatively cheap, but, you know, time consuming. Again, if you are talking, if we will talk about the constant portfolio of certain number of customers, which is constant and not changing every day, this could be also a solution, especially if you can have financial information of your customers through them, which is, you know, possible, like registers in the jurisdictions like, I'm pretty sure about the Belgium, I'm pretty sure about Estonia and some others. I mean, the global tendency is that all these state registers are becoming more and more open and available, so we are moving towards a much more transparent world of credit. But again, I'm not trying to predict the future, you know, with a certain degree of accuracy. Well, agencies, it's a pretty nice and comprehensive piece of information, usually, which you get at reasonable price. So you got business reports and you receive everything you reasonably need for your credit assessment. Again, content could vary depending on the jurisdiction, depending on the customer, and so on. But again, the pricing I see right now and the way I used to do it in my career shows that normally, you know, the price for the report, for the business report, is more or less the same amount of money you pay to your employee who collects the information per hour. So it is that there is a balance. There is a balance. Some companies use them, some companies use them. We won't be talking about business reports themselves, I believe. Those of you who use them already got your experience again, this is not, this is one of the sources. A good complement to business reports, a good complement to any other source of information are references. If you ask your customers to provide you referees, it's a very good practice, especially when it comes down to the new customer. So you can always ask your customer who can be their referees, their suppliers, their customers, their bankers. Having their permission, you can request that recommendation and got, kind of advice. Could be also done informal, again, as it's a matter of confidentiality and matter of your suppliers as a creditor, your good faith as a creditor, but this could be a good information. One important thing about all of that is you need to make sense of all of the information. That one thing, you need to understand what the exact piece of information really means, not to overestimate it and not underestimate it. And don't give every piece of information too much weight. You need to put everything, we need to put everything into the complex picture, and then only then we decide. And only then we estimate or assess the counterpart's creditworthiness. Only after that, because sometimes people start to. And this, by the way, I said, the right stage. There is a stage of collection of information, then there is stage of analysis of information, there is stage of conclusion. So if you try to do conclusion on the stage of collection of information, that could be a mess. That could be a method that's not very nice for the final job of the credit analyst and for the final decision as well. Well, this is the most, I think, could be also controversial, but if we really want to estimate how creditworthy our customer is when we talk about business, we need to see financial information. We need to see at least preliminary numbers or historical numbers or whatever numbers are, and preferably comprehensive. And this is, again, the financial statements exist. I was checking Wikipedia, the first balance was done by Italian monk about 400 years ago. And since that, actually, rules of accounting didn't change really substantially, so that it is more or less the same balance than it was done that time. So this is already a language of business, a language of money, a language of accounting which we need to read. And without numbers, all of our attempts to judge on the creditworthiness of a company or of a business is just guessing. Yeah, we can guess if there is no other information. But in order to, if we really want to evaluate customers' business or our trade partners' business, we need to have a look at financial statements, whatever people say about them. Every single specialist or every second specialist blame financial statements, and you've got these two statements like that. Yes, they do always hold. They are always old, no exceptions. They're always old because they're always outdated, they're always prepared on the some date in past, and we only try to extrapolate what we see on the future periods. And majority of piece of books and prediction models are actually dedicated to that. Take the past experience, take the past financial position, and try to extrapolate it on the future and see whether or not company has enough financial strength to cope with the future challenges and whether or not, you know, there will be still safe, alive, out of financial distress, out of bankruptcy, not go into the failure, so we can credit, grant them credit safely. Again, here there would be an idea about the amount. We cannot judge about the amount without numbers. As simple as that. Again, we can guess. We can calculate, you know, the number of, estimate we can estimate, for instance, by, I don't know, the number of trucks going in and out to estimate sales. We can try to look at the position of customer in terms of fixed assets, but we would never know about the liabilities, and the customer could be, you know, could be of very high net worth and technical bankrupt at the same time. Without financial statements, we would never know that. About the correctness, again, as any other report, financial statements are a form of report, of company reporting. And when we do our reporting, being honest, we all try to look a little bit better than we are, because there are expectations and financial statements. I'm not touching, you know, misleading or, you know, abuse of financial statements or, you know, like, you know, we all know what Enron case is. I'm just trying to say that if the financial statements are prepared in good faith and as correct as possible, being audited, they are still a little bit, they got certain degree of, I don't know how to say that, you know, being politically correct, they're a little bit better than the business is. It is not, again, there is a wrong case which was dramatic, you know, $30 billion of liabilities in the end, out of, you know, shown $30 billion in financial statements, in actually became $60 billion of liabilities and the company became a bankrupt. Obviously, this is a dramatic case. This is why we don't have Arthur Andersen anymore. But what I'm trying to say, every financial statement got, you know, sort of deviation from the truth, which is normal. But again, there is no better way. There is no better way so far to assess customer. Therefore, we need to look at financial statements. Whatever type of analysis you do, you look at them, you estimate default probability, and you estimate the company's financial strength, and you decide yourself, using your judgment, how much money could be trusted. You know, preventing the question how to judge about the amount, I would say among the specialists I'm in contact with, the specific amount to be trusted to the company is a certain portion of the company's total net worth. What is the specific percent? I won't be saying, because it's a matter of practice. Somebody says this could be 10%, 15%. Somebody says 50%. Other practitioners say that 15% is already aggressive. I must say this is all already subjective, but when we talk about definition of amount, we supposed to understand against what we put or against what we grant our credit. So either this is customer net worth, or either it is reputation of the owner, but we understand that quantitatively we take the risk and we just want to deal with this specific person or the group of the companies, but we're ready to agree on that, or we do it against the security, against something else. So again, we compare two amounts. We put our credit, which is credit demand of the transaction or the customer or the contract, with a specific worth either this is net worth of the company or something which we can retranslate or agree with. Again, just to finish that, there is no 100% correct recipe in this. It's only your experience and your judgment which help you to define this creditworthiness and be successful. One very important notice here is that there is endless cycle of credit where a lot of companies, believe it or not, simply assess their customer when the customer is coming for the first time. Then they forget about this because the customer is good, the customer pays. This is one of the biggest stereotype in terms of credit management, because creditworthiness of a customer, if we simply calculate it based on financial statements, is changing every day. And the credit demand is changing every day. And it is going up or down, we don't know. Therefore, we call it endless cycle, because we need to constantly collect the new information about the customer. We need to analyze it again constantly. We need to check whether or not our portfolio of customers is becoming more credit worthy, how much credit risk we take in our portfolio, more or less. And we go back to the setup. So we given a setup like new reassess or reestimate or review credit limit, payment term, and the security requirement, and we do go ahead. And this is actually the one of the secrets. We do that on a constant basis. Every customer in good credit department within the professionally organized suppliers or credit grantors, every customer is analyzed at least on annual basis. Some companies try to do that on quarterly basis. There are reasons for doing that and not doing that, but again, at least once a year, because annual financial statements are updated once a year. Again, having a look at that, being really business oriented. So credit assessment is not leading to change of the the credit structure of a customer, but when we say okay, credit worthiness is going down, and we go back to that to our colleagues in sales department, sometimes to management, sometimes even to customers, say, can you please explain what's going on? How can we deal with that? How can we cope with that? What is the solution? And so on and so on and so on. And across some basis, we've got new information, we analyze it, we put it, we look at the through the portfolio perspective, then we decide whether or not we keep set up, and we go and we go and we go and keep an eye on that, and this could be also considered as a monitoring process. Three things which actually helped me in my credit career. Three over, I would say. First of all, usefulness is over the professionalism. So whatever professional is in any area, not credit management only, this person or this specialist or even this system gives something useful or does not give. So it is either useful or not. Nearly black and white. There is very small gray area, but again, usefulness is much more important than professionalism. Again, if what you do isn't clear to others, it doesn't matter how accurate your analysis or whatever it is. If people don't understand, it really doesn't matter. And the last thing, again, it's not only about the credit management, but common sense overall. Every assessment, every decision supposed to make sense. Otherwise, there is no reason to, waste your time on that, waste your efforts on that. There should be common sense in everything what we do. Well, here are the contact details. Sorry, I'm sorry. I think I cannot move. Yeah, I think I'm done. little bit longer than it was expected in 50 minutes, but currently I'm done with my presentation.
Thank you very much for your time, Andriy. We look forward
my
to
pleasure.
Your
my
next
pleasure. Thank you for the opportunity.
And, and we shall talk very soon. As I said, looking forward to your next one. Okay.
Yep. Thank you very much, everybody. Again, if you've got questions, I will... I think it is here. You got my contact details, so they will be distributed. You can find them in the webinar brochure or find me on LinkedIn and ask them. I will be pretty happy to answer them. Again, thank you very much. Happy Easter. Have a nice holidays if you take them. And stay tuned. We will be on the next webinar with a new subject. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Goodbye.